And my name is David Selim Sayers. I'm a lecturer in Turkish studies at San Francisco State University. I lecture on a variety of Turkey-related topics. I lecture on Turkish and Ottoman history, politics, literature, cinema, anything that you can imagine that has anything to do with Turkey, I lecture on it. I've been especially involved with thinking about and talking about Turkish politics since 2013, when my wife Ekrem and I were in Istanbul on a grant that she got to do research for her PhD dissertation, and we found ourselves in the middle of the Gezi Park uprisings, and we took part in those uprisings pretty much for the entirety of June, I think it was 2013, and ever since we've stayed involved also kind of a bit more with the activism side of things. And although I imagine that if we were talking about this earlier, I imagine that if Gezi Park happened today, they would probably send in a suicide bomber, and that would be that. Anyway, so without further ado, the subject that I want to talk about today for you guys, give a bit of a background, is the sort of the relationship between the state of Turkey, the ISIS, the Islamist, the jihadist organization / state that we have in Syria and Iraq right now, and the PKK, which is a guerrilla organization that operates mainly within Turkey but across the borders from Iraq, Syria, and Turkey. This is kind of what I want to talk about today. People have been curious about Turkey and ISIS because it seems like Turkey is dragging its feet in fighting ISIS. It seems like Turkey is more interested in fighting its own kind of sort of the PKK, which is a group it perceives as its enemy, the Turkish state, rather than ISIS. What is the PKK? What does Turkey have to do with ISIS? Why is the situation like this? These are some of the things that I want to talk about today, because it can get pretty confusing in, when you read about the stuff in papers and you don't have enough background. Yes?
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but I wanted to say you could speak without the mic, because the mic is making all your words sort of running.
I would love to speak without the mic. I was told that it helps.
Okay, let's try with that mic then.
Can I leave
yeah.
it? Can I talk without it?
Yeah, sure.
Awesome. I totally thank you for very much for that. I really appreciate it. But I kind of sound self-important to myself when I speak with a mic. Can everybody hear it?
Yeah.
Okay. Excellent. So basically, what I want to say is Turkey seems to be, well, in a pretty unstable situation right now since. Late June, pretty much, more than 100 Turkish soldiers and police officers have been killed in violence between Turkey and this organization called the PKK. Civilians, you know, we have perhaps, you know, together with the Ankara, recent Ankara bombings, we have hundreds of civilians killed, maybe more than 200 civilians killed in the country, many, many more injured. We have more than 2,500 people by now. I'm sure that it's a couple thousand more detained in Turkey by the Turkish state for alleged links to the PKK. We've had attacks on 128 offices at least of the HDP, which is a pro-Kurdish party in Turkey. And there has been mob violence against Kurdish citizens all across the country. I mean, these are some of the scenes of destruction. This is sort of an HDP headquarters that has been attacked. Again, stuff dragged out into the streets. And another one set on fire. And this is a sort of, we're gonna talk more about this in a moment, Kurdish dominated towns being besieged by the Turkish police forces, by the Turkish military. It seems, I mean, when we're talking about a civil war, it seems what's going on is a civil war between the Turkish state and the Kurdish minority within Turkey, or at least people or movements that claim to represent the Kurdish minority in Turkey. Some examples for this, are, and this one's very famous, this one made it into the news, the lockdown against the town of Cizre, which is a Kurdish majority town in, as you can see here on this map. It's kind of pretty much right sort of in this border triangle between Turkey that you see up here, Syria that you see over here, and Iraq, which you see over here. The one town that seems closer to all those borders is this Turkish town called Salopi, and similar stuff has been going on there. Well, basically from September 4th to September the 9th, the Turkish military performed a lockdown on the town of Cizre, where they didn't let anyone in or anyone out. Electricity and water and basic services for much of this town were shut off. And there were street battles. You would think that you were, I don't know, you would think that you were in the West Bank, you would think that you are somewhere in some town in some sort of ISIS embattled town in Syria. If you look at the scenes of destruction from the town after finally, basically on September 9th, I think 5 days later, people were allowed back in, and you could see these scenes of destruction from the fights between the Turkish military and Kurdish militants in the town of Cizre. There were more than 20 casualties in the course of this event, and not just people who were out there fighting with guns, but kids were born during that time but couldn't be taken to hospitals. They got sick, like little babies died. Elderly people died because they got dehydrated. There wasn't water, there was no running water and stuff like that. Nobody could go out to buy anything, buy medicine, etc., etc. Snipers were all around, so you couldn't leave your houses, you couldn't leave your apartments, but you'd immediately get shot at. And even elected representatives from the Turkish assembly, from the Turkish parliament, were not allowed to enter this town. And this is not just this town. Similar scenes played out in a number of the Turkish border towns, mainly on the border to Syria, which have a predominantly or absolutely Kurdish population. Okay. So just to give you, my friends gave me a few videos to play from specifically from Cizre, so I just want to quickly run those by you. And this is an announcement. This is a night in Cizre that basically somebody from their house was filming via their smartphones or something like that. And the police makes quite a remarkable announcement during this. So I just want to play this for you. And sound is the problem, but it doesn't matter.
Sound we can make it.
Do we have? Oh, sweet. Can you roll that over?
Yes.
Sorry for the delay, guys. Thank you. Can you just pull the whole thing?
Not too much.
Yep.
Okay. Almost
okay,
there.
Okay, that's it.
I got it.
There you go.
I got it. Okay. So now we just need the sound over there somehow.
Yeah, it's supposed to be on.
Okay, here we go. So the gunshots that you're hearing, obviously a conflict, armed conflict between the Turkish army and insurgents within the city. And in a moment, the Turkish police is going to make, we don't even know, the security forces that are attacking, are they police, are they army? Okay, the Armenians are proud of you, they say. All of you are Armenians. So very, very interesting announcement. So here, an inhabitant of the town is replying, Prime Minister, Prime Minister of Turkey, this is enough. Please stop attacking this town. It's pretty much the gist of what she's saying. So, but what is it really interesting here is that the Turkish security forces attacking the town are making announcements to the population saying, You are Armenians, or the Armenians would be proud of you. A very open and blatant reference to the Armenian genocide, which the Turkish state denies having carried out during World War I, back when it was still the Ottoman state. And here you have Turkish state officials basically making a not so very veiled threat, saying, well, yesterday what we did to the Armenians, today we're going to do to you Kurds, right? And thanks to social media, we're getting these kinds of images filtering out to us in spite of a complete media lockdown on these places where these things are happening. So the next thing that I'm going to show you is visually actually much more disturbing than what we just saw, and it's a video shot by a Turkish police officer from a Turkish police vehicle as they are dragging the corpse of a Kurdish militant behind the vehicle through the streets of the city. So if you if you don't want to see this, you might want to look away. Wait, let's find out where is it. No, okay, here we go. I don't know how to do that. I think that's probably enough. So in this case, what you see here is a blatant attempt by the Turkish security forces in Cizre to intimidate the population by these kinds of tactics, where they say, okay, if you resist, if you don't obey the Turkish state, this is what you can expect to happen to you. So images of incredible violence, images of incredible brutality, and slogans being pronounced by the Turkish state that take you all the way back to things like the Armenian genocide. Yes, just a snapshot of what's going on in Turkey right now, and I want to take you guys back actually to what happened, right? Why is this happening? But before I move on to that, of course, I should take a moment to talk about something that you might have been following in the news regarding Turkey recently, and that's a number of suicide bombings, a number of very scary attacks, very traumatic attacks that have been happening in Turkey. This is the first one, actually, that set off the chain. It happened all the way back in June 5th, 2015. It was carried out by this person. This was not a suicide bombing. He laid the bombs during a rally of the pro-Kurdish party, HDP, during an election rally in the Kurdish, so basically in Diyarbakir, which is considered to be the capital of the Kurdish regions of Turkey. So Diyarbakir is pretty much a Kurdish capital in Turkey. You can see it here on the map. So Cizre is over here. Diyarbakir is over here. You can see that we're still talking pretty much about the same geography, the regions of Turkey that are very close to the Syrian border and mainly inhabited by Kurds. So the pro-Kurdish HDP was having a major election rally there when these bombs went off when this bomb went off on June 5th, 2015. And during this event, four people were killed and over 100 were injured. The next one in the series was a bombing in Suruç, which is a border town right on the other side of Kobani. And you might have heard of Kobani. Kobani is a town that Kurdish forces were defending against ISIS earlier this year, and where they managed to repel ISIS and where they managed to hang on to the town. So what was happening on July 20th was that a group of young Turkish activists, Turkish Kurdish from all kinds of backgrounds, had gathered in Suruç, which is just across the border in Turkey, and were preparing to cross the border to go over to Kobani for humanitarian aid, to help in Kobani. And before they did that, they made an announcement, and during that announcement, a suicide, like right right during the announcement, while it was being broadcast, a suicide bomber detonated himself in the middle of the group making the announcement. And there is a video for this. This is absolutely horrific. And in that incident, 32 people died and more than 100 people were injured. So these two events lead us up to the suicide bombing in Ankara that happened just a couple of days ago on October the 10th. Again, there was a gathering, basically a gathering denouncing the kinds of things that we've just been talking about. Why is Turkey in such a state of civil war? We want peace. A lot of people, especially opposition parties, opposition politicians coming together, it was going to be a massive rally for peace, for reconciliation of the different groups. And again, during this rally, two suicide bombs went off. And this went down in Turkish history as the deadliest terror attack in the history of the Turkish modern Turkish state. According to the official count, 97 or 99 people died. According to unofficial counts, more people died, maybe 120, 130, something like that. And over 500 people were injured, dozens of them critically. Now, but what emerged after this third bombing was that actually all of the bombers in these three instances knew each other. They were part of the same cell. They were part of the same jihadi cell with connections to ISIS. Apparently they had been trained by ISIS just across the border from Turkey in Tel Abyad, and they had fought against Kurdish forces in Tel Abyad, and they had returned from there to Turkey to carry out bombings, first in Diyarbakir, then in Suruç, and then over there, all the way over there in Ankara, the capital of the Turkish Republic. And what was even more shocking was that it emerged that the Turkish state had known about the cell for months, if not for years. They had known the names of these people. They had family members of these people had reported them to the police, saying, "My son or my daughter, I suspect that they are involved with ISIS. I suspect that there's something going on. You should arrest them. You should pull them in." But the Turkish state had in some cases brought in some of these people for questioning, but then released them again, and they had gone back to their training in Syria, to their ISIS training, etc., etc. After the Ankara incident, the Turkish state released this had been released months ago, but attention was drawn to the fact that this wanted list, this person of interest list, was going around. It had been distributed to all of the Turkish police forces across the country, and nobody had done anything. These people were under surveillance. These people had been wiretapped. Their phone conversations had been recorded by the Turkish state, but nothing had happened. So very clearly, it seems like just in the case of Suruç, where you saw the Turkish police shouting out, calling the Kurds Armenians, the Turkish police dragging corpses of militants behind police vans. In this case, also the message seems to be, we know who is doing this. We know who is responsible for these attacks. But if you are against us, if you are against the Turkish government / state, we are not going to protect you against things like this, right? You oppose the Turkish state at your own peril. We know what's going on, but we're not going to stop it from happening if you are against us. So this very strong sense that the civil war that seems to be kind of getting a reality in Turkey is actively being pushed by the Turkish state itself. So it seems it's not like a war or not like a conflict, like an ethnic conflict where the Turkish part of the population is sort of riled up against the Kurdish part of the population. They're fighting each other and the Turkish state is kind of trying to keep things calm or trying to keep things under control. It seems like the Turkish state itself is an active participant in not soothing the sort of tensions that are going on, but rather escalating the tensions. Why? What's happening? Yes?
Yeah, I have a question.
How can you define current government, AKP, and Erdogan's role in that case?
We're going to come to
that. Yeah, because when you call it like generalist government.
So we're going to come to that. I've kept it a little bit general until this point on purpose, just to convey the sense that people get reading this of how confusing this whole thing is and how weird it is. Yes. Yes,
correct?
That is correct.
So if they were actually carried out by ISIS jihadists, but that was not what made it out of the media, do we take, should our understanding be that that was the Turkish government's suppression of that information?
That's a fantastic question. That's also going to get answered further on in what I'm going to talk about.
We should hold on the question until he finishes the presentation. That way, he does his presentation.
But these are great questions, and these are the these are exactly the kinds of questions that you should be that people should be asking themselves. What and I'm going to try to give you a little bit of history, a little bit of background information that's going to put you all, help you. I'm going to try to help you put all these things in perspective for you. What is happening? Why is Turkey like this at the moment? Turkey is not necessarily a country that is in the news, has been in the news for this kind of thing for a very long time. Turkey is a pretty major country that borders on Europe on the one hand and on the Middle East on the other hand. It has a population of 80 million. That's a sizable population. It's about more than a quarter of the population of the United States. And it has one of the world's top top 20 economies. It's a NATO member, so it is an ally of the West. Here you can see a poster all the way back from after World War II, from the Marshall Fund days, where basically you have the slogan, whatever the weather, we must move together, with the United States is kind of indicating the direction in which this contraption should move. States that are getting help from the Marshall Fund inside, and Turkey as the only Muslim state that is part of this Western alliance. Turkey is also an EU membership candidate. Turkey is a country that is in accession negotiations with the European Union. So in a lot of ways, things were looking okay for Turkey, right? We have a regional powerhouse, one of the world's top 20 economies, strong ties to the West, part of NATO, in accession talks with the EU. So things should be on some trajectory of democratization, et cetera, right? I mean, why this descent into violence? Why this scenario that we see right now? So in order to understand that, we need to go back and look at the relationship, firstly, between the Turkish state and the Kurdish minority within Turkey. So I want to talk a little bit historically about that. Right? One of the ways that I would define the Kurdish population is as divided by maps. This is the region in which speakers of some of the different Kurdish languages live. As you can see, the Kurdish population lives in Turkey, predominantly, as a matter of fact, in Turkey, but also in Syria, Iraq, and Iran. The Kurds do not have their own state. When, after World War I, the regions that belonged to the Ottoman Empire around here were split up among the French and the British, etc., the Kurds did not get a say. The Kurds were not invited to the table. Nobody asked them whether they wanted their own state, etc., etc. So the Kurds were pretty much divided up among these different nations that were defined by lines drawn in the sand or by lines drawn across mountains, as it were. Kurdish identity is not and was not a unified identity. There are many different Kurdish tribes. As I just said, there are different languages. And the community, which was a tribal community anyway, was refragmented with the drawing of these different borders after World War I. So that, for example, very different education systems set up in these different nation states started producing Kurds with very different outlooks on life. Turkey with a more secular education system, for example, whereas Iraq not as secular as Turkey, and for instance, in their language getting divided in ways that they weren't divided before. The Turkish state, after World War I, when it was founded, adopted the Latin alphabet. They used to use a form of the Arabic alphabet. But for example, Iraq sticking with the Arabic alphabet, so that if you were a Kurd, right, who together with his clan or his extended family was living across this region, one day you woke up to find that one part of your extended family was now in a different country. You were not allowed to go there. Previously, if you had brought, for example, if you'd grown something over there and brought it over there, it was your normal trade. Now it was considered smuggling. And now you were being educated in different school systems of different nation states that were sometimes educating you in different alphabets even, so that your connections, your organic local connections were being lost. Kurdish identity as a whole, the fact that Kurds today speak more of themselves as a united group, is more a result of 20th century oppression rather than anything else. The more that Kurdish groups in these different countries were discriminated against by the nation states, the more they gained an understanding of themselves as a united group and started emphasizing their own Kurdish identity. In Turkey, the Kurdish minority is a huge group. Turkey has anywhere between 20 to 25% of its population that can be identified in one way or another as Kurdish. From the beginning of the Turkish nation state that was set up in 1923, there has been violent suppression of Kurdish movements, whether these be violent armed movements for independence from the central state or cultural movements, movements that wanted to preserve cultural language, Kurdish languages or Kurdish customs. Here you have a photo of Sheikh Said, who was a Sunni Kurdish tribal leader and the main commander of an uprising named after him in 1925, executed by the Turkish state. And here you can see, kind of in this photo, like very neatly demonstrates kind of the Turkish state's official standing next to him, representing the modern sort of overhaul that this state was trying to give itself, whereas Sheikh Said standing in the middle clearly still stands for a very different, older tribal identity. You might as well have put someone, like put people from the 20th century next to somebody from, I don't know, the 17th century or something like that, right? That's the kind of thing that you see going on there. Forced cultural assimilation of Kurds, sending their kids to Turkish schools, forcing them to learn the Turkish language, banning the Kurdish language, and forced mass relocations. So, for example, if there were uprisings, or if a certain area of this kind of region was considered to be particularly unruly, the Turkish state would go in and raise villages to the ground and mass relocate the Kurdish population to different parts of the country, so that trying to break the critical mass of Kurdish population in the region. So all kinds of suppression of Kurdish identity. We're talking here though, and that's important to point out, we're talking about a cultural rather than a racial discrimination. If you're in Turkey, there is not necessarily a way that you can just by looking at someone tell that they're a Kurd. Right. So what the message that the Turkish state was sending out was this: as long as we are building a new nation state. In this nation state, we want everybody to be Turks. As long as you self-identify as a Turk, As long as you speak Turkish, as long as you pursue as long as you pursue a lifestyle that is acceptable within the new nation state, as long as you don't emphasize your ethnic identity, it's okay. You're part of this state. The problem starts if you want to preserve your language, your heritage, your identity, etc., etc. So as long as you are willing to assimilate to Turkishness, opportunities were open for Kurds in Turkey, right? And some of them rose very high. Some of the most successful Turkish businessmen are Kurdish. Some of the most well-known Turkish politicians have been Kurdish, but not Kurds who have emphasized Kurdishness. Kurds who have left that sort of aside and have assimilated within the system. Now, the Kurdish rights movement, kind of trying to preserve Kurdish cultural identity and trying to sort of end, let's say, the state of emergency that has been ruling these regions within the Turkish Republic. That is something that started in the 1960s and the 1970s as part of the broader movement of the Turkish political left. So in the 60s and the 70s, like in many places in the world, the left was on the rise among student movements in Turkey, on university campuses. There were campus occupations, there were riots in the streets, there were a lot of young Turkish student, charismatic leaders, leftist socialist leaders of student movements. And these people, coming from a socialist ideology, recognized the demand of the Kurdish movement for cultural recognition, right? So these leftist movements were on board with the idea that Kurds should be able to propagate their own culture. So Kurdish, the fight for Kurdish rights took place as a part of the general Turkish leftist movement. But over the years, especially in 1970 and 1980, Turkey experienced a number of military coups d'etats, which basically aimed at suppressing the left, because remember that Turkey at this point is a NATO member, is an ally of the West. So NATO and the US has a vested interest in keeping leftist movements in Turkey down. And so basically these military coups suppressed leftist movements in Turkey and gradually helped open Turkey up to the neoliberal world economy. Kind of like the situation that you had in places like Chile, right, with Pinochet. Very, very similar situation where leftist movements are stamped out and the local economy is opened up to global so-called competition, right? After the 1980 Turkish coup d'etat, which was pretty much the most hardcore one and which paralyzed the Turkish left, maybe for decades, the Kurds, or Kurdish activists, decided to splinter off from the general Turkish leftist movement and to pursue Kurdish rights in particular, to go their own way. Because they said, okay, as part of this general movement, the Turkish state is cracking down on this general movement in a very, very hardcore way. The only way that we can pursue our struggle is if we tie our struggle specifically to the struggle of the Kurdish people on the ground in the Kurdish regions of Turkey. We need popular grassroots support to keep this going. So they divorce themselves from a more sort of universal leftist message and tailored their message more specifically towards the Kurdish population of Turkey, focusing more on the ethnic oppression of Kurds rather than on things like class struggle, right? So they changed their emphasis in that way. And that is how the PKK came into being. Okay, the PKK is shortened for the Kurdistan Workers' Party. As you can see, a socialist emphasis here. This is the first flag of the PKK in Kurdish on there with founding date 1978, but they really became active after the 1980 coup d'etat. This is the man who founded the PKK, Abdullah Öcalan, also known in Turkey as APO. And this was basically set up as a guerrilla organization with socialist principles, opposed to oppression of Kurds by the Turkish state, as I said. This is a very mountainous region, so the understanding was that they would draw on support from local Kurdish villages and local Kurdish youths would flock to the cause. They would set up training camps and escape routes throughout the mountains, also passing into Iraq, and that would be their way of sort of pursuing guerrilla action against the Turkish state. So this started in the 1980s. But they were not only opposed to oppression by the Turkish state, they were also opposed to many traditional religious tribal features of Kurdish society itself. Because Kurdish society is a very tribal society, is a very patriarchal society. It's a very feudal society in which landlords pretty much own the peasants around them, etc., etc. So the PKK, being a socialist organization, was not just struggling against the Turkish state, but also struggling to reform certain traditional features of Kurdish society. And that is why you see so many women in the ranks of the PKK or the PYD fighting in Syria today, right? The idea being that one of the main tenets of the PKK is male-female equality. That is one way in which they are trying to undermine the tribal sort of basis of traditional Kurdish society, right? And a lot of women will join the PKK, a lot of girls will join the PKK, not because, maybe not so much because they're upset with the Turkish state, but because they see joining the PKK as a way to escape a feudal system where they would have to, like, basically get married at their father's whim and have 10 children and never have a say over their household, etc., never get an education, never get a career, right? This was an escape route for a lot of Kurdish girls, Kurdish women, a way in which they could assert themselves and devote themselves to a cause that was worthier than what they saw lined up for them within traditional Kurdish society. To date, 40,000 people or more were killed on all sides in the guerrilla war between the PKK and the Turkish state. So we're talking massive numbers here, right? 40,000 people, mostly civilians, in Kurdish villages that were razed by the Turkish army, etc., etc., killed in this low-intensity, if you will, civil war going on between the Turkish state and the PKK. The PKK basically being an organization that the more the war goes on, the more oppression the Turkish state seems to be visiting on these regions, the more the recruiting system of the PKK is fed, because that's how people get disenchanted and join the PKK. The scenes that you saw at the beginning, right, when I was showing you the videos of the people dragged through the streets or the things that the Turkish security forces were saying, this is something that we are gaining awareness of today thanks to social media, thanks to this kind of thing getting out. But in reality, very similar scenes have been a part of life for the Kurdish population since the 1980s at the very least, okay? But we weren't getting this information because social media didn't exist, and these parts of Turkish territory have been ruled at pretty much under a kind of permanent state of martial law and emergency, not allowing any kind of regular reporting to take place. So just because we see this violence today doesn't mean that it started today. We just see it today because today we get access to social media. In 2002, Turkey, the Republic of Turkey, came under the rulership of the AKP. This is the symbol of the AKP. The AKP stands for Justice and Development Party, and it's an interesting party that pursues a combination of Islamic social policy and neoliberal economic policy, wedding a sort of very Islamist social discourse with a pronouncedly neoliberal approach to the economy in terms of privatizations, in terms of opening Turkey up to foreign investments through things like stock markets, etc., etc. So a sort of textbook combination of a conservative social ideology and a neoliberal economic ideology. In 2002, on the heels of a major economic crisis in Turkey, the AKP swept into power in a spectacular election where they won a total majority in the Turkish parliament. And this was a party that had just been founded. It was a very new party, but it had its roots in the Turkish Islamist movement. And the AKP, of course, is headed by this person, Recep Tayyip Erdogan, who has been in charge of the AKP pretty much since the beginning. Under the AKP, peace talks, for the first time ever, were started between the Turkish state and the PKK. First, in 2009, they started in secret, and in 2011, they were made official. The AKP, the rhetoric employed by the AKP to justify these peace talks was an interesting one. So remember that the Kurds were given pretty much in the Turkish Republic the option of either assimilating to Turkishness or resisting and facing an uncertain fate. The AKP tried to reframe this debate by saying, well, we are a party with Islamic values. The Turkish part of the population is Sunni Muslim, and so are the Kurds. We can unite via religion. We can use religion to bring ourselves to bridge our ethnic divides. That was the rhetoric that the AKP was employing in order to make in order to market these peace talks to the general population in Turkey. And partly as a result of these peace talks, the AKP received significant votes from the Kurdish population in Turkey. Significant. As I said, the Kurdish population is about 20 to 25% of the Turkish population. So by appealing to the Kurdish population, the AKP was able to win a stunning series of electoral successes to the point that this party has ruled Turkey since 2002 and still rules Turkey today. And partly responsible for that was the fact that they were reaching out to the Kurdish population and getting a large part of the Kurdish vote as a result. Now, what happened, though, was that peace talks didn't just benefit the votes of the AKP. Peace talks also helped to legitimize the political arm of the Kurdish struggle itself. Right. Until this point, you had a number of Kurdish, pro-Kurdish parties that were founded in Turkey, as you can see, sort of starting from 1990, 1993, 94, 97, 2005, 2008. Why are there so many? Because they were periodically getting shut down by the Turkish state, right? So these parties would emerge as political arms of the PKK's guerrilla struggle. Sort of, you can imagine them like Sinn Féin to IRA in Ireland. But the Turkish state engaged in battle with the PKK would shut these parties down, thereby denying any kind of political legitimacy to the struggle of the Kurds. But once peace talks started, hi guys. Once peace talks started, legal Kurdish political movements started gaining traction in Turkey, and most prominently among them, the HDP, which is a pro-Kurdish political party. And you can see here a much older Abdullah Öcalan. He is now a prisoner of the Turkish state. And to his left, we have the co-chairman of the HDP today. And to his right, another HDP politician, demonstrating that, on the one hand, the link between the PKK guerrilla struggle and the Kurdish political movement continues. Right? So still we're not thinking of these things as completely separate, but now, thanks to the peace talks, this movement is saying we are ready or at least willing to move this from the arena of armed struggle into the arena of political debates and elections, right? Maybe we can take our fights for Kurdish rights and Kurdish autonomy before the electorate. Maybe we can discuss this in parliament. Maybe there is a way out of this, violent quagmire. This party yielded Demirtas over here. This party fielded him as a presidential candidate in 2014. In 2014, Turkey had presidential elections. And he netted very close to 10% of the vote. Most of his vote, as you can see, came from the Kurdish regions. This was absolutely unheard of in Turkish political history, that a pro-Kurdish candidate should come anywhere near 10%. Why is 10% important? In the 1980 coup that I just showed you, this one over here, one of the things the generals did, they wrote a new constitution, and one of the things they did was they established an electoral threshold of 10% in Turkish elections, which is the highest electoral threshold in the world. For parties to get into parliament, they have to get at least 10% of the overall vote in Turkey, or else all the votes they get are forfeit. And this was brought in specifically so that Kurdish parties would not be able to enter parliament. As a result of the peace talks, for the first time, the Turkish state found itself faced with a situation where perhaps a Kurdish party had gained enough traction, enough legitimacy, that they could pass 10%, which was a historical situation. So the question became for the AKP, okay, we're conducting these peace talks with the Kurds, but are they helping our vote or are they hurting our vote? Are we getting more votes out of the Kurds as a result of this peace talks, or by legitimizing their political struggle, have we actually lost votes because all the Kurds now are starting to identify themselves with the Kurdish political movement, right? So in terms of electoral politics, in terms of the vote that was at stake, the peace process became questionable for the AKP. Is this worth it for us, right? Is it worth it? Are we going to continue gathering the votes this way or not? That's by way of background into what has been going on between the Turkish state and the PKK until very recently. Now I want to move us over to Syria and ISIS and connect that sort of whole problematic with what's going on with the Turks with the Kurds in Turkey. Now, the first thing that you should know about Syria in this context is that from 1980 to 1999, Syria harbored the leader of the PKK and gave the PKK access to form training grounds in Syria. So the PKK is a guerrilla organization in a large part in its early development was helped and supported and sheltered by the Syrian state, by Assad's father, by the current Assad's father. Why did Syria do this? Well, mainly the reason is this river that you see over here, the river Euphrates, which is one of the most important rivers in world history. It has harbored Mesopotamian civilizations for thousands of years before Christ. The river Euphrates originates in Turkey, runs through Syria, then through Iraq, and into the Gulf of Persia. And Turkey controls the source of the Euphrates, which is one of Syria's most important water supply routes, okay? So Syria, in a way, was using the PKK as a bargaining chip against the Turkish state, because the Turkish state was developing projects to dam the Euphrates, to control how much water could make it down into Syria, etc., etc. So the PKK, for the Syrian state, was a handy pawn, in a way, that Syria could use to destabilize Turkey if Turkey threatened to go ahead and jeopardize Syria's water supply. So that way, the PKK was able to establish itself in Syria from a very early point onwards. At the same time, in the 1980s, obviously, as all of you know, Iraq and Iran were fighting a war, and the power vacuum that that war created enabled the PKK to ensconce itself in the mountains in the north of Iraq. So in the 1980s, the PKK built up its presence both in Iraq and in Syria. In 1999, under Turkish pressure, Syria deported Erdogan, the leader of the PKK, and he was captured by Turkey, but still the PKK remains entrenched in Iraq and Syria, to the point that the PYD, that we hear about a lot these days as the Kurdish force, along with, so the PYD is a political party, and the YPJ is the military arm of that political party, right? And we hear a lot about them in the news, how they are fighting ISIS, and how they have managed to secure a broad region of the Syrian-Turkish border against ISIS, right? The PYD and the military arm of the PYD are basically outgrowths of the PKK. They are part of the same organizational structure. So you can even see that very clearly, the relationship between the groups from the flags and from the banners as you see them there. The HPG is the military arm of the PKK, the YPG is the military arm of the PYD. So you can see in their banners, in the way that they present themselves, the combination of the Kurdish colors plus the socialist star, you can see that this is the same blueprint. These are subdivisions of the same overall organization. The PYD fighting ISIS in Syria today, effectively fighting ISIS in Syria today, has grown out of the PKK presence that established itself in Syria since the 1980s under the sheltering protection of Assad. Now the AKP, in the course of the Arab Spring, the Assad regime in Syria became shaky, and it started to look like Assad might be toppled any day, or with a little bit of a push from the West, just like Gaddafi was, etc., etc. The AKP, Turkey, took a very hard line against Assad, insisting that Assad must go. And along with the West, along with many other countries that were part of NATO, Turkey started supporting, in terms of military support, in terms of weapons, in terms of logistics, Turkey started supporting groups that were opposed to Assad in Syria, right? And among these groups, as we now know, were a lot of different jihadi groups, a lot of different jihadists that were getting direct support from Turkey, along with support from many other countries that wanted to see Assad gone. What does Turkey want in Syria? Firstly, Turkey would like to replace Assad with a ruler or a regime that is more pliable to Turkish influence. Turkey wants to increase its influence in Syria and kind of dominate Syria rather than have Syria stand there as a potential rival in the politics of the region, right? For example, when Assad's father was in charge and Syria was backing the PKK against Turkey, that is an example of a regional rivalry, the kind of rivalry that Turkey wants to avoid with a new regime in Syria. Secondly, what is really, really important for Turkey is to prevent the creation of a Kurdish autonomous zone on the Turkish-Syrian border. Right, the zone that the PYD holds today, the zone that the Kurds are defending against ISIS, is exactly the same zone that Turkey would like to see as a safe zone where nobody is in charge, where basically a no-fly zone, where the Kurds are not in charge, ISIS is not in charge. It's just like a liberated no-man's land. That's what Turkey would like to see there. Why? For the obvious reason that since the organization in charge there is de facto a part of the PKK, Turkey fears that once they have control of that region, that they will want part of Turkey as well. They will want to expand into Turkey. They will become more forceful and powerful in their negotiations with Turkey, and Turkey will have to yield concessions to the Kurdish movement that it doesn't want to yield. So, to Turkey, ISIS is a lesser evil compared to the PYD or the PKK. Why? ISIS, for one, does not make any claims on Turkish territory. ISIS is not saying, we want rights in Turkey, this part of Turkey is ours, you should grant us autonomy in this part of Turkey, right? ISIS is not after Turkish territory, or at least that's the way it seems at the moment. Secondly, ISIS is fighting Turkey's enemies. ISIS is fighting Assad. ISIS is fighting the Kurds. So ISIS is pretty much fighting everybody that the Turks want to fight themselves. Okay, so ISIS is, in that sense, a military proxy for Turkey. And one thing that you guys should know is that roughly one third of ISIS is made of Turkish citizens, okay? So you cannot think about ISIS as if they were some kind of race of aliens that were dropped into the region and just appeared out of thin air. These people came from somewhere, and one third of ISIS are actually born and raised Turkish citizens. ISIS has much support among AKP circles. As I said, AKP is a party that has an Islamist social policy that pursues an Islamist rhetoric at the very least, right? Even though its economic policies do not gel with Islamism very well. So in its Islamic core, the AKP is full of ISIS supporters. So ISIS support overlaps with the AKP's core constituency. So Turkey kept up its support for jihadi groups in Syria until this year, and even now Turkey is on the fence about jihadism in Syria and in Iraq. For instance, Turkey, a couple of months ago, committed to coordinated airstrikes with the United States on ISIS positions in Syria. Well, some investigative reporting has been done, and in all the months that the U.S. has been striking, whatever they've been striking in Syria, from Turkish air bases, supposedly in coordination with the Turkish Air Force, there is not one confirmed incidence of the Turkish Air Force itself effectively striking and destroying an ISIS target. Not one. There was one instance in which the Americans claimed that Turkey had hit this or that mobile ISIS target, one instance, and in that one instance, the Turkish officials came out and said, no, 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 you got that wrong, that was the Americans, right? That wasn't us. So they denied responsibility for hitting any ISIS target. So obviously Turkey still on the fence about hitting ISIS in Syria. Now, moving on to the next important kind of turning point in the triangle, in the relationships between Turkey, Syria, ISIS, and the Kurdish movement. And that was the siege of Kobani. In the spring of 2015, Kobani, which is over there, where the red pointer points at, which is a Kurdish inhabited town on the Syrian side of the Turkish-Syrian border, inhabited by Kurds and controlled by the PYD, that is what Kobani is, was besieged by ISIS. And this map kind of shows you a way in which, sort of, the ways in which ISIS was kind of advancing on the city. This is the Turkish border over here, and this was sort of the area in which the Kurdish defenders of Kobani were boxed in, were trapped. Turkey did nothing to help Kobani, even while the US itself was supporting the Kurdish resistance by airstrikes against ISIS. You can see here a Turkish tank right across the border from Kobani, just sitting there and doing nothing, okay? So you have a situation in which ISIS had encircled and was attacking a Kurdish town right on the Turkish border. The United States was performing airstrikes to help the Kurds. The Turks themselves were doing nothing, waiting for ISIS to fall, waiting for Kobani to fall to ISIS. But the PYD, with US support, actually managed to push ISIS back and liberate the city. What that did was, well, it was a small, well, Kobani is a small fish in the overall thing that is going on in Syria, but for the Kurds, the Battle of Kobani became something like the Battle of Gettysburg. It became a defining moment in which Kurds had managed to sort of save a region, save a city, protect it, defend it against overwhelming odds, not just against ISIS, but also in spite of the lacking support from the Turks who were sitting just behind them and waiting for ISIS to take the town. As a result of Kobani, a large part of the Kurdish voting population in Turkey, until that point, they'd supported the AKP. They said, enough is enough. We're gonna go with the pro-Kurdish party. We're gonna go with the HDP. You gotta imagine the Kurds in Turkey as like the main fault line that divides the Kurds in Turkey is religion. On the one hand, you have sort of socialistically inclined Kurds that feel closer to the PKK and its political arms. On the other hand, you have a sizable Kurdish population that still sort of supports the old Kurdish, more religious lifestyles, right? And this was a split that the AKP had been able to exploit by gathering the votes of the religious Kurds and not leaving the other Kurds with enough support to be able to be politically effective. Kobani united these two fronts. Kobani brought Kurds together across the dividing line of religion and socialism and whatnot and said, okay, we are Kurds first and foremost, and we have to stick together. The Turkish state has sold us down the river. The Turkish state has like, you know, in this life and death situation, the Turkish state left us out in the cold. Even religious Kurds started feeling that the struggle for Kurdish autonomy took precedence after Kobani. As a result, in general elections that happened this June, the AKP, for the first time in more than 12 years, lost its parliamentary majority because they lost the Kurdish vote. For the first time since 2002, the AKP lost its parliamentary majority. This was the parliament before the June elections. You can see the AKP in yellow with a sort of sizable, with a comfortable majority in the Turkish parliament. And after the June elections, you can see the AKP pushed back, and you can see that the main reason that the AKP is pushed back is that the Purples, which is the Kurdish party, have won votes. So votes have migrated from the AKP to the Kurdish party, and because of that, the AKP has lost its parliamentary majority. And at the same time, as if that wasn't enough, it wasn't enough that the AKP has lost its stranglehold on Turkish politics, at the same time, in Syria, with US support, the Kurds carved out a zone right on the Turkish border. The PYD carved out a zone right on the Turkish border, pushing ISIS back from its positions on the Turkish border, and creating exactly the kind of de facto autonomous zone that Turkey has been trying to prevent. Okay, so both militarily a disaster for Turkish strategic interests, and politically a disaster for the AKP's electoral prospects. Ever since Kobani, Turkey's Western allies have been pushing hard to get Turkey more involved in the fight against ISIS. This summer, Turkey finally allowed some of its air bases to be used in attacks against ISIS, but as I said, as I told you, Turkey's stance on the whole ISIS issue is still pretty much up in the air for reasons that I've outlined above. So, in wrapping up, when this happened, when Turkey opened up its air bases to Kurdish to U.S. strikes against ISIS, Turkey, at the same time, pretty much immediately, started striking PKK positions, ending the peace process that had been going on between the Turkish state and the PKK for a couple of years. So they were performing airstrikes into northern Iraq, where the PKK has strongholds, and at the same time, they started the kinds of operations that I showed you at the beginning of this class inside Turkey, besieging Kurdish towns, where there was a lot of Kurdish resistance against the Turkish state, and other measures like that. So the AKP, the Turkish state, right now is rekindling the civil war against the Kurds. Why? The AKP wants to re-marginalize the Kurdish movement in Turkey. After those elections that I just showed you, they refused to form a coalition government, forcing a snap re-election, which will happen on November the 1st. So they refused to accept, okay, we're not the biggest party anymore, we have to make a coalition. They refused that. Instead, they said, no coalition, we're going to have another election. And this time, you better vote for us, right? So ever since that election, they have been escalating the violence between Turks and Kurds in the hopes of re-marginalizing the Kurdish movement and pushing the Kurdish party back down under 10% again, so that they can regain their majority in the Turkish parliament. And also, of course, it's not just a war of sort of ideological perceptions of the Kurdish people. Also, in concrete terms, on the ground, with Turkish forces besieging or de facto occupying a lot of the Kurdish territories, they can manipulate the vote in the upcoming elections. They can say, for example, that in certain regions you can't perform a vote for security reasons, etc., etc. So it gives them a lot of leeway in manipulating the vote that is coming out of the Kurdish regions of Turkey. And all of this is why Turkey is right now seems to be on the brink of civil war. All of this is why the situation has escalated to the point where it is right now. So that was very long. Thank you very much for listening. See, when you're fighting a war on the ground and where you're going to get your support wherever you can get it, if things get much more complicated. It's also very complicated for the United States right now. Would you rather... the United States is stuck between Turkey, which is a major military partner, and a major buyer of U.S. arms from the U.S. arms industry. Stuck between that, so a major partner on the one hand, but very reluctant in the fight against ISIS on the other. And on the other hand, you have the PYD, a much smaller organization, a socialist organization, as you said, standing, which is like against a lot of the things that the US stands for, but they are effectively fighting ISIS on the ground. So it's a complicated situation for all parties concerned. Necessarily an involvement that you can draw out along clean sort of ideological lines on paper, right? You're gonna be involved with both sides and then see what happens at the end of the day, right? Just like a lot of mega corporations in the United States today will make donations to both political parties and then see what happens at the end of the day, right? In the same way, you're gonna have a global player like the United States hedging its bets as to what is useful in this region in terms of realpolitik when it comes to supporting on the one hand the Turkish state, selling them the arms that they need in order to attack the PKK, and at the same time supplying the PKK itself with arms that it needs in order to fight ISIS.
Oh, PYD.
Yeah.
Okay.
One more question.
Elated by that outcome. It seemed that the AKP had been given a message whereby the Turkish people wanted a coalition, they didn't want the AKP to rule the country alone anymore, the AKP was deprived of its majority, the Kurdish sort of political movement had become a legitimate player in the political arena. It seemed that things were looking up, right? That election result seemed positive. But in the months since then, we've seen that the AKP and also other Turkish political parties, for cynical reasons, have stopped a coalition from emerging, have stopped the political situation from stabilizing in hopes that if things get more extreme, a better outcome would await at the end of the next election. So now we're waiting for the elections on November the 1st, right? And polls indicate that the outcome is not going to be very different. Polls indicate that the AKP will not get its absolute majority back, that again we're going to have a hung parliament, and again possibly coalition talks, et cetera, et cetera. I think it's very, very hard to tell what's going to happen. Will there be vote rigging? Will the AKP kind of... game the deck so that they will be able to regain their absolute majority? If it's hung again, what will happen as a result of that? And one very important thing, what will happen to the Turkish economy, right? The AKP holds on to about 40% of support within Turkey on the strength of its economic performance. The Turkish economy has developed under the AKP in a way that has benefited a wide range of upper middle class entrepreneurs in Turkey. Them and their employees are vestedly interested in AKP political success. So the AKP will continue to be the major player in Turkish politics until the Turkish economy collapses. So the question that you want to ask yourself is this, right? If the Turkish economy is keeping going because the AKP is there, would an economic collapse be worth it for the AKP to leave? Different people with different interests might draw different conclusions in that situation.
The last program we interviewed some Turkish journalists who are covering Turkey from the union there, and also this guy named Ali, who's with Sindika, which is a labor website in Turkey. It has labor news and information. So I wanted to, as part of this presentation about what's going on in Turkey and the relationship to the United States and the working class here, talk about the developments in Turkey, because actually you have to start with what's happening in imperialism. It's not simply a Turkey question. The United States is breaking up countries like Libya, like Syria, and Iraq, and Afghanistan. And this is having spillover effects in the whole region, because these countries actually were set up by imperialism, and now imperialism is breaking them up. So we have to look at what effect this is going to have in Turkey, which itself was a formation that came out of, well, the defeat of imperialism. So this question of what's going on in Turkey is connected to the whole crisis of imperialism and the wars in the Middle East. But the rise of Erdogan and the AKP in part is a policy of the United States in the 1980s of the 1980 military coup, of setting up a military coup where you could have privatization in Turkey and where you could privatize the economy. The economy in Turkey, a large part of it was state economy under Kemal and the Kemalist movement. The role of the United States was to support a military coup in 1980 and to crush the working class, the unions, and Kurdish people, put them in jail, and forced a large amount of people to leave Turkey, Turkish people and others. There was repression of strikes in Turkey, and repression of the working class. What we've had in the past number of years in Turkey is that not only a movement of the Kurds, but also the working class is growing in power and strength. There have been the most recent one was the metal workers' strike, right, of about 40 or 50,000 metal workers, auto workers and others, which was a spontaneous strike independent of the old unions in Turkey, which is a very important political development. These workers basically got fed up with the trade union bureaucracy and said, we're going to organize ourselves. And there were the tekel workers, the textile workers, who had a strike against privatization of the tobacco company in Turkey and had a hunger strike in front of tekel. There have been Istanbul Hyatt workers and other hotel workers, Dora hotel workers in Istanbul. So there's been a movement of the Turkish working class. And for us, I'm with also the United Public Workers for Action. What is critical is, for us in the United States, is linking up with the Turkish working class, with the unions and workers in Turkey, against American policies, the IMF and the World Bank. The IMF and the World Bank were, in fact, instrumental, the Morgan Bank, in privatizing the Turkish economy. And when, for example, Telecom, the telephone company, which was a national company, was privatized, one of the major stockholders was Lawrence Eagleburger, who used to be the Secretary of State. He ended up getting a percentage of Turkish Telecom. So for the capitalists, capitalists in the United States, the privatization of Turkey has been a vehicle to take over large parts of the Turkish economy. And that's what they've done. Now, I think one of the things that I wanted to also say is that we fought in San Francisco for solidarity against the repression in Turkey in solidarity with the Turkish workers. In 2003, the San Francisco Labor Council passed a resolution against the repression in Turkey. There's a copy of it here. And also recently, the media workers passed a resolution against the repression of Turkish journalists. Because the other thing that's happening in Turkey is there's a massive attack, not just on the left press and the Kurdish press, but Hurriyet and major newspapers in Turkey. And they've kidnapped them, they've killed them, and that indicates a split in the Turkish capitalist class itself. When they start attacking major newspapers, you're not talking about a minority group, you're talking about big capitals who are under attack within Turkey, very important politically. Also, the Gulen movement, Fethullah Gulen, was a supporter of the AKP. Part of the United States was supporting fundamentalism, not just in Turkey, in the region, against the left, against the working class and the left movement. And Fethullah Gulen was a supporter of the AKP, and his party, he not only was involved in Turkey, but he was allowed to come here by the CIA, and he helped set up the largest number of charter schools in the United States, Magnolia schools and others in the United States. And these schools are virulently anti-union, and he's the largest charter operator in the United States, the Gulen Foundation. So the issue of privatization in the United States of education through charter schools, and his is one of many, there's a KIPP, there are many other private charters in the United States, is connected to what's going on in Turkey. the privatization of public education. Because the Islamization or the religious, the push to force religion on people in Turkey is part and parcel of what the United States has been doing in supporting these governments. So I think we need joint solidarity between the working class in the United States and the working class in Turkey. And I think one of the important things to note about the last massacre in Ankara is that was called not only by HDP and supporters of peace, but also the unions in Turkey. There were union contingents at that were bombed. So this was a direct attack on the Turkish working class in that massacre. And I think it'll have a political effect within the working class, that the policies of the AKP government are a direct attack. Now, this is not new as far as massacres, because the Turkish workers have faced massacres throughout the last decades. For example, in 1976, before the coup, there was a massacre of DISK, and 42 people were killed by the Turkish state. So I think that the question now is the defense of the Turkish working class against U.S. military rule. Now, I think the United States is playing a double game, obviously, in supporting the Kurdish people, but against ISIS, because in reality, who is funding ISIS? Who is behind ISIS, fundamentally? In the Saudis. And these regimes, these Gulf regimes. Who is supporting the Saudi and the Gulf regimes? It's the United States. The United States is really the force that allows ISIS to operate. I think that is one of the things that I think in the United States people do not understand. I mean, what happened? Where did ISIS come from? How did ISIS develop? It developed because the United States allowed Saudi Arabia and the Gulf states to support ISIS. That's why ISIS developed. And ISIS is also a product of what happened with the U.S. intervention in Afghanistan, where the United States supported bin Laden and fundamentalists against the Russians. So I think that there's a direct connection between the rise of fundamentalism in the Middle East and the United States' role in propping up regimes. So I think we in the United States have to link up the struggle here against privatization, the attacks on the working class here, against militarization and imperialist intervention, with the struggle of the working class and minorities in Turkey. And the question is, what is going to happen in Turkey? Well, Turkey may break up. That is a possibility. I mean, I don't think that it's out of the question that the whole region now is coming apart. And the ability of the Turkish bourgeoisie to keep in control of the situation when countries around it are being broken up is in question. Now, and that is part of what's happening in the Middle East. And that's why a section of the capitalist class in Turkey is against the AKP, because they see that these policies could lead to the breakup of Turkey. And I think that's something we have to look at as a possibility. Not that it's definitely going to happen, but that's a possibility that may happen. So I want one last point. I mean, the Gezi movement and what happened in Gezi, which I think is important, because the Gezi movement was a mass popular protest against the government, but also against privatization of public spaces. And the basically kicking people out, building things, removing people, depopulating people for speculators that are represented by the AKP, private capitalists, and it united for the first time a large part of the population. And that was an important also political development that led to the HDP getting more power. And my view is that the election is not going to solve anything. First of all, they're going to try to rig it, but the social conditions in Turkey are not going to be solved by an election, whoever wins. And that has to be solved by the working class in Turkey and the working class in the region, and with socialist solutions, with working class solutions. And I think that's really what we have to fight for in the United States and link up with American workers against the attacks, because the United States is the government that's supplying Turkey militarily. The United States is supplying them with the weapons, the gas, the tear gas that was used in Gezi was by the United States. So the United States is a key factor in allowing Erdogan and the AKP to do what they're doing.